Good morning. Usually as a minister, one of my greatest challenges is to determine what I should speak about on a Sabbath morning. It's usually not hard to find a topic or find a text. In fact, sometimes the greatest difficulty is trying to narrow it down. As you study, you have all kinds of ideas and things you want to share. But I really believe that God has given me something today that I think is very applicable to probably everyone who hears my voice today. And it's called Our Light Affliction. And actually, that's just simply part of a verse in the Bible. Does anyone remember which verse in the Bible speaks about our light affliction?
It's Paul speaking.
It is Paul, isn't it? Sure. It's in 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 17. But I'd like to read, as we begin, 2 Corinthians chapter 4. We're going to start in verse 7 and read through verse 18. So open your Bibles with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Starting in verse 7. To the end of the chapter. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency, the power, may be of God and not of us. We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. Always bearing about in the body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our body. Verse 11. For we which live are always delivered unto death for Jesus' sake, that the life also of Jesus might be made manifest in our mortal flesh. So then death worketh in us, but life in you. We have the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believed, and therefore have I spoken. We also believe, and therefore speak, knowing that he which raised up the Lord Jesus shall raise up us also by Jesus, and shall present us with you. For all things are for your sakes, that the abundant grace might be through the thanksgiving of many redound to the glory of God. For which cause we faint not, but though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. And now that verse 17. For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. I was reading a story this week about a young man. He was a fresh new Christian, and he's attending a Christian school, and he comes into his dorm room just bursting with enthusiasm, and he says, Is it really true to his roommate? He says, what's really true? He says, well, this verse, it says that if you have faith, you can move mountains. Well, you can't say no, right? Yes, it's true. That's what the Bible says. And we do believe what the Bible says. And sometimes we may be challenged with those kind of verses. But what about this verse 17? For our light affliction, which is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. Is it really true?
Yes.
Can we believe it?
True.
Can we put it into life and see how it works in our lives? And I think sometimes we read the Apostle Paul, and we maybe even read Jesus. And we just say, and you know, maybe we don't say it out loud, we're not that brave. Are you kidding, Paul? Really? What do you mean, our light affliction? Because some of us are going through what seems to be some pretty heavy affliction. Some of us are having family issues. Some are going through depression. Some are battling cancer. Some of us are just getting old. Some of us have children or grandchildren. How dare you call it light? But Paul is writing under inspiration. The Bible says holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Spirit, right? And so he knows, friends, exactly what he's speaking about. The problem is we don't understand all that he's saying sometimes, or we don't appreciate the magnitude of the promise that is given to us. Now it's interesting, this expression, light affliction, that Paul mentions, if you go back to the original Greek, it's elephron tais philipsis. And there's the Greek for it. But it means, the root word for affliction there, philipsis, means literally to press or squash, hem in, than to be narrow. It means to have pressure in a physical sense. So when it says I have this affliction, it means I have this pressure on me. It's like I've been put between two big guys and they're just squeezing against me. Interestingly, this word, if we go to our next slide, and we see this pie chart, we see how it's translated. 18 of 45 usages of this word in the New Testament are translated afflicted, affliction, or afflictions. But even more times, this word is translated tribulation or tribulations. 21 out of 45 times, it's also translated trouble, anguish, persecution, and burdened. So when he speaks here about our light affliction, he could be talking about our light trouble, our light persecution, our light burdens. All these things are encompassed in this word. One place this word is used that has become one of my favorite verses is in John chapter 16. Let's turn there. John chapter 16 and verse 33. John 16 verse 33. Jesus said, "These things have I spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation." But it's the same word translated affliction there in 2 Corinthians 4, 17. He says, "In this world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." And because he has overcome the world, friends, we can overcome all these afflictions, all these tribulations that are ever given to us. But you might say again, Alan, how can you call them light? How can you agree with the Apostle Paul that the things I'm experiencing are light? Well, I'd like to give you seven reasons today. Seven's a good number, isn't it? The number of perfection. I want to give you seven reasons today why I believe that this is true. The first one is, your affliction is light when compared to that of many others. You know, you might think your affliction is doing the dishes. You might think your affliction is doing homework. You might think your affliction is having a broken down car. It might be sick. And some of us are quite sick, it's true. But no matter how heavy, there are others that are worse. And that's no cliche.
That's right.
That's no cliche. Have you ever heard of William Carey? Mm-hmm. William Carey, the father of missionaries, as he sometimes is called, the father of modern missions. He began his missionary career in India in 1793. He served the Lord in that country for 40 years, never once returning home to England. And throughout those years, he translated portions of the Bible into dozens of the different languages of India. But one afternoon, after 20 years of hard labor, a fire ravaged through his printing plant and warehouse. All the printing equipment was destroyed. But even worse, all of his precious manuscripts went up in flames. Now remember, this is before things were typed out on a computer. There was no flash drive this was backed up on. There was no hard drive. It wasn't burned onto a CD-ROM. And this was before we had typewriters. There wasn't a carbon copy someplace else. This was it. And it was all gone. 20 years of nonstop labor gone within a few hours. Many people would have been devastated over a loss like that, but not William Carey. This is what he wrote to a pastor friend in England. He says this, "The ground must be labored over again, but we are not discouraged. We have all been supported under the affliction and preserved from discouragement. To me, the consideration of the divine sovereignty and wisdom has been very supporting." And then he quoted from Psalms 46:10, where the Lord himself says, "Be still and know that I am God." That's from Mills and Paro's Finishing Well in Life, pages 101, 102. So I ask you, do you have a broken down car maybe? Sir Ernest Shackleton, in his transantarctic expedition, had a broken down ship. The ship was encased in ice, just miles from the coast of Antarctica, where they were trying to get to. And finally, that ice, up to 10 feet thick or thicker in places, decided it was going to take that ship and crush it like a match, and it surely did. And now here's Shackleton. He has no place to go to get his boat fixed. It's unfixable, even if he did. I don't know if you can understand what this meant to them. He didn't have a big spare boat. They didn't even have an ocean to get back into. It was just all ice. They had no phones, they had no radios, they had no internet. I mean, in practical terms, this was like going to the moon on a rocket ship, and then this rocket ship fails. And then after the ship was taken down by the ice like this, Shackleton calmly looked at his men and said, "Ship and stores are gone, therefore we will go home." And you say, how in the world are we going to go home? That sounds hard. That sounds hard. But hoping against all hope, a year and a half later, they got home. Probably most of us have heard of Stephen Hawking, the theoretical physicist from Cambridge and Oxford universities, once scored Oxford, then later at Cambridge. Has motor neuron disease, also called ALS, better known in America as Lou Gehrig's disease. He was diagnosed as a young man, told he'd have about 2 years to live, and he's lived many, many years since then. He's lost virtually total control of his whole body. He only uses his eyes now. All he can use is his eyes. He can make motions with his eyes. It triggers a sensor in a computer. He can type still with a computer. Pretty tough way to live, year after year after year. And I say, and what I'm saying now, what I'm going to say, I want you to understand. I say with no demeanor in any way toward these people. But this is sometimes things that make our affliction seem a little lighter. And the next man I'm going to tell you about, Joseph Merrick. Any of you recognize the name Joseph Merrick? He had a disease that my son had. So this is a little close to home for me. But Joseph Merrick maybe had it about as bad as you can get it, called neurofibromatosis. He was also known as the Elephant Man. He lived as a freak sideshow in the 19th century. But this is what the disease did to him. No, maybe we don't have it so bad. Maybe there are people in this world, it's no cliche, who have things a little tougher than we do sometimes. The Apostle Paul, he endured afflictions. He speaks of his experiences. In 2 Corinthians chapter 12, in this very same epistle that we take our lead text from, 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 7 through 10. He says, "And lest I should be exalted above measure through the abundance of the revelations, there was given to me a thorn in the flesh, the messenger," the Greek is angel, "the angel of Satan to buffet me, lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord thrice." And that's an old English word for how many?
Three.
"Three times that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, my grace is sufficient for thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake, for when I am weak, then I am strong." In verse 9, "And he said unto me." In the Greek, this is the active indicative form of it. And what it means is, it's like the final word. Don't bother me again about this. This is the final decree. This is the way it is. My grace is sufficient for you. You don't need to pray about this anymore because this is the decision. And Paul says, that's good enough for me. What was his thorn in the flesh? We're told. Spirit of Prophecy tells us, and it's found in Volume 6 of the Bible Commentary on page 1107. Paul had a bodily affliction. His eyesight was bad. He thought that by earnest prayer the difficulty might be removed, but the Lord had his own purpose, and he said to Paul, "Speak to me no more of the matter. My grace is sufficient. It will enable you to bear the infirmity." Isn't that beautiful? It just matches exactly with what the original text says. Don't bother me anymore about this. I'm going to help you through this. And so, friends, when we have our light afflictions, You know, sometimes the Lord chooses to remove those afflictions, but sometimes we have to live with them. And when we do, we just have to realize that God has grace that is sufficient for every minute of every day.
Amen.
And it doesn't matter what we're going through. He has that ability to do that for us. Paul not only had this thorn in the flesh, and we don't know. I mean, this probably could have been to a degree related to the blinding light that he met Jesus with on the Damascus Road. You know, because Paul's older at this time. Maybe he was having macular degeneration. Maybe he was having glaucoma. We don't exactly know what was causing his eyesight problem totally, not all of it. But you can imagine if you were going blind, or if someone's listening to me who maybe is blind. It's more challenging. You can think of all the good that would be easier to do if you could see better. You know, as Paul says in one of his epistles, he says, I've written to you this large epistle, as if he's writing. I mean, it's like this is one of the few he's writing, not dictating. It's like he's having to make the letters big so he can see them. I've seen people who had such bad eyesight, they'd use a computer screen, and they would have things magnified so big there'd be one letter on the screen at a time. They're trying to make that one letter out. You know, I don't like wearing my glasses. I was mentioning to Thomas and Raquel last night. I can't read anymore without them. I mean, I guess I could read if the letter was that big, you know. But I'm thankful I have what eyesight I have. God has been good to me, and I appreciate that I have glasses. I appreciate technology. Technology is not all bad, right? We talked about that in Sabbath school some. Technology has its greatest, great, great advantages if we use it properly. But Paul had other problems. In 2 Corinthians chapter 11, it says in verse 24, of the Jews, five times received I 40 stripes, save one. Verse 25, thrice I was beaten with rods, once I was stoned, thrice I suffered shipwreck. A day and night I've been in the deep. In journeys often, in perils of water, in perils of robbers, in perils by my own countrymen, in perils by the heathen, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren. Of course, they didn't tell Paul they were false brethren, did they?
No.
They said, we're genuine historic Judaism here, right? Absolutely. In weariness and painfulness, in watchings often, in hunger and thirst, in fastings often, in cold and nakedness. And Paul didn't always fast, friends, just because he wanted to pray. He fasted a lot of times because he didn't have food. He was hungry. He says, beside those things that are without. So we have all these things that are without. But he says, there's something that's even, if there's a light affliction, it's a little unlight, not quite as light. And he says, that's the care of the churches. The care of the churches. And that's the people, not the buildings, not the general conference, not an organization. It's the care of those people that make up God's people. That's what really burdens me down, he says. The care of the churches. Paul is not writing in our text today in 2 Corinthians 4:17, our light affliction. Paul's not writing disconnected from his own experiences, disconnected from his other writings, disconnected from the reality of what he knew that the people in the churches were facing day by day. So we might say the first thing is that yes, it can be worse. Others do have it worse. That's true, and it's not a cliche. Our second point is your light affliction is light compared with what you deserve. Because the Bible says, actually, in Romans chapter 6 and verse 23, that the wages of sin is death. And that, friends, is the wages that we each deserve right now, today. In Matthew chapter 8, in verse 12. Matthew chapter 8, in verse 12. Jesus says, but the children of the kingdom shall be cast out into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. It's true, we don't believe that God has an eternal burning hell going on right now, or that we'll go throughout the ceaseless, unending ages of eternity. But friends, there is a heaven to win, and there's a hell to shun. And Jesus said there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. It is unworthy to be compared to the woes of the lost, anything that we experience right now. You actually deserve the woes of hell. And that is where each one of us would end up, friends, if it was not but for the grace of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
I remember Brother Glenn telling a story. And to use modern vernacular, to make this a little more correct politically, we'll just say there was an African American during slavery times. And he was on trial in the South for a crime that he committed. And he was shaken. He was nervous, you know. And the judge looked at him and says, "Don't you worry, you'll get justice in my courtroom." And that man looked at him and said, "Sir, I don't need justice, I need mercy. I need mercy." You know, friends, God is just, but we need mercy. That's what we need today, is mercy, each one of us. And it's only because of God's mercy that we have not already been consumed and received what we deserve. Point number three. Your light affliction is light compared to that of Jesus Christ. In Luke chapter 24 and verse 26. Luke chapter 24 and verse 26. Jesus, as he was speaking to these disciples, he says, "Ought not Christ to have suffered these things and to enter into his glory?" Did Jesus suffer? He absolutely did. The Bible says in Isaiah 63 and verse 6, Isaiah 63 and verse 3, I believe, that he tread the winepress alone. He drank the dregs to the very bottom of the keg. In Matthew chapter 27 and verse 46, Matthew 27, 46. There he said simply, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani," that is to say, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" The experience that Jesus went through was one that was totally devoid of any connection that he could experience or know of between him and his Father. And that is an experience you will never ever be asked to have. Jesus died the death that was promised to Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden, that they would receive if they sinned. The death that sin would bring to the lost at last. Jesus felt it as much as any human being can feel it, because the Bible says in all things it behooved him to be made like unto his brethren, Hebrews 2:17. And in verse 18, it says that he himself has suffered being tempted. And therefore, the death that Jesus died on the cross was that full, bitter cup of despair and ruin that is the eternal wages of sin. This had to involve the hiding of the Father's face from him, as he said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?" A place, a situation where there's seemingly no hope, no light, no expectation of a resurrection to brighten his despair. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians 15:3 that Jesus died for our sins. Romans chapter 5 and verse 8, he says simply, he died for us. He experienced in his final suffering the darkness that veiled from his sight the expectation of a resurrection. Had Jesus been buoyed up by the hope of a resurrection, friends, to that extent he would have come short of truly tasting death for every man, as it says in Hebrews 2:9. At best, he could have only lent himself to us. It's no wonder that Christ's human nature recoiled from that terrifying experience when he was in Gethsemane and the weight of the sin of the world was begun to be laid on him, and that separation was beginning to happen between him and his Father. And he sweat great drops of blood. And he groaned. And he said, "My Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as thou will be done." Matthew 26, 39. The cup which he drank was a cup that no other human being before or since has fully tasted. In fact, as one man said, Jesus Christ is the only person to have ever truly fully died. The full terror of hopelessness, the experience of the second death, is what he tasted in the full consciousness of its killing reality. Neither the nails driven through his hands, nor the feet that were pierced by the nails, nor the floggings killed him. He scarcely felt the physical pain, we are told. It was the spiritual pain that broke his heart and killed him.
Amen.
And I'd like to propose to you today that the very one who regulates, who measures, who weighs and determines the afflictions that you receive, he knows exactly what they are like personally. And he's promised not to allow you to be tempted above that which you're able. Your afflictions will never be anything compared to the afflictions of Christ. We are told that the temptations of Christ were as far high above us as his divinity was above our humanity. Mm-hmm. And friends, his afflictions were too. Your affliction, point number four, is light compared with the blessings that you receive. And just maybe quickly, we could just think about some of those blessings. And as I was thinking about this, I had a hard time narrowing it down to just a few I wanted to mention. But we experience the blessing of salvation, John 3:16. That we have a God who loved us so much that he gave his only begotten Son for us. The afflictions that we have are light compared to these blessings. The blessing of knowing a personal Christ, a personal Savior. The blessing of receiving righteousness. You know, the Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 30, that Christ is our righteousness. He's our wisdom, our sanctification, our righteousness, our redemption. He's everything to us. And righteousness is simply right doing. Jesus enables us to do right. 1 John chapter 3, and verse 1, behold what manner of love the Father has bestowed upon us, that we should be called the sons of God. We are the sons of God. We are children of God. We have been adopted into his family. And the Bible says in Romans chapter 8 and verse 17 that we are heirs and joint heirs with Christ. You want to join heirs, don't you? You know, in the Old Testament, the way it was done in the patriarchal system, you poor ladies for the most part got left out. Except for in the case of those children of Zelophehad. But there are no sons there. But their sons, you see, you ladies got left out. But the oldest son got what? A double portion. And so he wasn't a joint heir. He was an heir with him, but he wasn't the same kind of heir. He had a better position. I mean, if you were the firstborn son, you got a double portion. You became the head of the family, and you got the priesthood. You know, in the old patriarchal days. That was a really, really important position. But you know, the Bible says that we're heirs and we are even joint heirs with Christ. We receive just what Jesus Christ receives. Isn't that a blessing? Can you think of anything else God could give us for our light afflictions? In fact, let's turn to Romans 8. I quoted verse 17, but I'll read you verse 18. Romans chapter 8 and verse 18. Verse 17, if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may be also glorified together. And so friends, don't think that you're going to get this joint heirship, these blessings, without also suffering with him. But then he says in verse 18, for I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us.
Amen.
And so no matter what we're going through right now, friends, no matter how difficult it is, Paul says it's not even worthy to be compared to what we're going to receive. Now I go back to the story we had at the very beginning. The young college kid come in who's just fresh convert, and he says, the Word of God says this. Do you really believe it? And I'm asking you right now, do you believe Romans 8:18? Mm-hmm. Is it really true?
It is.
It's true, friends, and it's true in you when you believe it. All we have light afflictions, it's true. Weeping endureth for a night, but joy cometh in the morning. Psalms 30, verse 5. No amount of affliction can take these blessings away or outweigh them. You know, we can have everything taken from us. This is the front gate to Auschwitz concentration camp. I've been there. And you can go through the museums that they have there. And in one of the museums, you'll see an area bigger than this sanctuary. And it's full of just shoes. just shoes. And then you'll see another area, and it's maybe overcoats. Because when these people were brought in, they were stripped of everything they had. And when they were killed, they would extract their teeth so they could melt the gold out of them, out of the fillings. In other words, everything that these people had, their possessions had already been taken, their lands had already been taken, their lives were taken, and now even the gold fillings were taken from their teeth. Anything they had was taken. Everything was taken. Everything was stripped away. But friends, if we are in Christ, no man, no devil, no nation, no one can take salvation from us.
Amen.
And they can never take Jesus from us. Yes. Nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, friends. No creature, Paul says, neither height, depth, nor any creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus. Number five, your affliction is light in comparison to the benefits that you get and to what it benefits you. You see, Paul says, if we go back, and let's just go back and read it again, 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 17. Notice the wording. For our light affliction, which is for but a moment, worketh for us. Oh, it's just not simply that there are things that are better. This thing's working for me. It's working for me, it says. It's working for me. Affliction, first of all, proves the power of sustaining grace. Afflictions prove the power of sustaining grace for us. In 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13, we all know that text, right? There's no temptation taken you which is such as common to man, but God will with the temptation also make a way of what? Escape. Why? Because of sustaining grace. Because God will sustain you with His grace, and the affliction proves it and makes it real to us. Affliction is designed of God to make changes in you.
That's right.
To drive sin out from you. Charles Spurgeon said, trials teach us what we are. They dig up the soil and let us see what we are made of. And friends, when we see what we're made of, it will lead us to Christ and lead us away from what we are.
Amen.
It will develop character. James chapter 1 and verse 3, if we could turn there, please. James chapter 1 and verse 3. Knowing this, this is a surety, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. That the afflictions, the tribulation, the troubles work patience. They develop our characters. In the book Christ Object Lessons on page 61, we are told, through conflict, the spiritual life is strengthened. Trials, well-born, will develop steadfastness of character and precious spiritual graces. The perfect fruit of faith, meekness, and love often matures best amid storm clouds and darkness. Where does it come best at? Storm clouds and darkness. Do you really want it? You know, we just had a camp meeting about perfection of character. We said we want this perfection of character. Do we really want it? Because here's part of the package of what happens when you get it. But friends, the good news is the affliction, the tribulations you get, they're light. They're light, because that's what the Word of God says. In Romans chapter 5, these afflictions, they will deepen our walk with God. Romans chapter 5, verses 3 through 5. And not only so, but we glory in what? Tribulations. Same word for afflictions. Also, knowing that tribulation worketh patience. James told us that too. And patience experience, and experience hope, and hope maketh not ashamed, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Spirit, which is given unto us. Point six. Your affliction is light because it is relatively brief. Paul says it is but for a moment. Well, tell that to Stephen Hawking, who's been living with Lou Gehrig's disease now for 50 plus years. It seems hard to think of it that way. But friends, we need to understand things in their relative position of time and understand the big picture, because eternity is a long, long time. Long, long time. At Camp Ming, I told you a little bit about Chad Williams. Chad Williams was a Navy SEAL, and he's a Christian. He wrote a book now, and it's called Seal of God. Seal of God. But he's a Navy SEAL. See, he's a Navy SEAL, but he belongs to God now. And from a young child, it had been his dream to be a Navy SEAL. His father tried to talk him out of it more than once. But seeing that he couldn't be persuaded, he actually arranged for a former SEAL to begin training Chad and working him out to show him just how hard it was, how difficult it was, hoping that he would, you know, decide to drop this idea. But it didn't change Chad's mind at all. And so his SEAL class started with 173 members. But only 13 graduated. Almost all of them dropped out. Very few were just put out. Chad spent nights in 50-degree ocean waters. He'd run 8-mile warm-ups in full gear in the loose sand of the beach, and he would swim 50 meters underwater without breaking the surface for air. He learned to suffer pain in silence because crying out could endanger a team on a mission. And then he tells a little bit of his experience. I'm going to read to you a little bit, share a little bit of his own words about this, and I have a reason for doing this, and I don't want you to miss it at the end. He says, more than 20 members of our class doored. That was an expression they had, meaning to quit, in the first few days of BUDS training. You go into SEAL training, you have what they call BUDS training first. After that, it seemed like we lost 10 to 15 more each day, so that by the end of the first week, just over 100 members of our class remained. A pattern emerged. One person would say he was considering quitting, and others of us would encourage him to stay. Don't do it, we would urge him. And that person, might hang on for another evolution, which was a training exercise, maybe even two. A few would stick it out until the next day. But I noticed that once the idea of quitting had been planted, that was it. Not one person who admitted he was thinking about quitting ended up staying, no matter how hard we tried to convince him. It wouldn't be long until he walked away, making that humiliating trek across the beach and toward the berm. Even with their backs to us as they walked, we could tell some of the quitters were sobbing as we yelled, "Come back, don't go." But they would disappear over the berm, and we would soon hear the bell ring 3 times, bing, bing, bing. They had a little bell. When you quit, you rang the bell, you put your helmet down in a row. The next time we returned to the training center, their helmets had been added to the line that stretched its way further and further along the ground. But then Chad tells about his friend Brett. And his friend Brett was the hardest of all to see break away. He says, Brett and I were swim buddies. SEALs always have a swim buddy. Instructors liked to single Brett and me from among the swim buddy groups, and we were usually the first to be called out. "Where are my prom boys?" an instructor would ask. The instructors never missed an opportunity to pounce on a mistake that we made so they could embarrass us in front of the class. They also attempted to make our tight friendship work against us. "We're going to make both of you guys quit," an instructor would snarl in our faces. After the instructors split us up and assigned other buddies, they played mind games with us. "Hey, your buddy just quit," an instructor would tell one of us. We never believed them. "Hey, man," I'd tell Britt when we'd meet back up after class. "They tried to tell me you quit." "Yeah," Britt would say. "They told me you quit too." I didn't believe it. The instructors actually liked us. They certainly got enough free entertainment calling us prom boys. But their job was to see who could consider every reason to quit and then not to do so. Brett did well from the start of the first phase. He was great at running, push-ups, pull-ups, and he was good enough at swimming. That's one reason I liked being his swim buddy. We worked well together We were probably having about as good a time together as could be had while spending an entire day running, exercising, getting beat up by the ocean waves, having sand stuck in places nobody wants it stuck, and being yelled at by our instructors who were trying to make us walk out of our dream. Near the end of the first week, we were introduced to an evolution called wetsuit appreciation. Wetsuit appreciation. was one of our toughest days, partly because it was one of the coldest. Our class was split into halves on different parts of the beach, and Brett and I were in different groups. The instructors had placed buoys about a quarter mile out into the ocean. You know, not far, really, at least not for a Navy SEAL, right? A quarter mile away. Go swim around the buoy, they told us, and we did. Now, that would be a quarter mile out and a quarter mile back, so they're swimming a half mile in cold water. And they did. When we got back to the shore, they said, go do it again. And we did. That cycle kept going for what seemed like forever. We never had any idea how many more times we would have to make that swim in the cold water, but we assumed that there would always be one more swim. Finally, the instructors ordered us out of the water. We had to run 4 miles, they told us. When we finished the run, they met us with, do another 5. After that, we were handed wetsuits, not winter wetsuits. They'd had winter wetsuits on prior to this. These were spring suits, which covered our upper bodies, but only went down to our thighs. They were also hand-me-down, and wetsuits do have a shelf life. My suit bore 8 stenciled names that had been crossed out. So it had been used a lot. In other words, it wasn't in very good shape. It didn't really keep a lot of the cold out. In those suits that had seen better days, and wearing fins called duck feet, we had to swim out past the buoy and back with our swim buddies. It was practice for going through the surf zone. We were supposed to stay within 3 feet of our swim buddies, and I was paired with a guy who wasn't a fast swimmer. I was getting slowed down by my partner, and the cold was getting to me. I figured that the quicker we finished our swim, the sooner we would be on dry land. We kept swimming the circuit over and over and over. I would grab my slower partner and actually start pulling him through the water so I could get an extra few minutes on the beach before we returned to the cold ocean. Then the wetsuit appreciation portion of the evolution began. The instructors told us to remove our wetsuits and make the swim again. Next, it was take off your t-shirt and do the swim. Eventually, wearing only our underwear, we made our final trip around the buoy. I was even colder than usual from having circled the buoy so many times when our instructors sounded a siren to signal us to immediately come in. On the beach, the instructors told the boat crew leaders to take charge of their men. Get a head count of your guys and put your clothes on. My hands and fingers were so numb I could barely tie my laces on my boots. When everyone mustered or gathered back together to get accountability and find out who remained and who was left, word began circulating that Brett was gone. No. I immediately thought, the instructors are just messing with us again. They're hiding him from me, so I think he quit. Brett quit, a class member told me. I didn't believe him. The bell began ringing over the berm. Bing, bing, bing. A short pause. Bing, bing, bing. Another pause. Bing, bing, bing. The bell kept ringing. Wetsuit appreciation had created a line for those who had had enough. Okay, seriously, where is Brett? I asked the others. He quit, Chad. He quit. Chad says, I was stunned. It seemed like destined that we would become SEALs together. We'd gone through junior high school together, high school together. Unbeknownst, we had enlisted in the Navy on the same day together. We had done our boot camp together. We had entered SEAL training together. We had been beside each other every step of the way, and only a few hours earlier, Britt had told me that the instructors could never make him quit. Britt and I didn't make contact with each other for probably 3 weeks. I think he actually avoided me for a time because I started calling his cell phone at the end of each day and could never reach him. When he finally talked, he described how ashamed he felt about quitting. During wetsuit appreciation, he said he just didn't think he could take it anymore. He became overwhelmed and went over the berm, began ringing the brass bell 3 times, placed his helmet next to the others, and returned to the barracks for a warm shower. As soon as the warm water of that shower had melted away the cold, Brett started crying tears of regret. After the shower, while still in the barracks, he saw our class without him for the first time. Our torture was over, and we were preparing to run to the chow hall. Brett watched us on our way, realizing that things weren't so bad for us anymore, and that if he had just hung in a little bit longer, he would still be there with us, headed indoors for a warm meal. Instead, he returned to the ocean side by the berm, lay on the beach, and wept. Well, that's quite a story, isn't it? It's a long story, I know. But I think it was worth our time, because the point is, do you see the point? He thought this was going to go on forever. He thought this was too long, I can't hang on. And then just after he gets warmed up, he sees these guys coming along, and they're fine now, and they're going to chow. And he says, oh, if I had just stayed a little longer. It seemed so long to me, but it was just a relative short time. And friends, there will be many who will be weeping outside the city of God because a short time seemed too long. They'll be weeping outside the city. They won't be joyous inside the city. They'll be weeping outside the city because they thought that a short time was too long. This short time may be viewed as relative when we compare it to even our lifespan, and I want to tell you, when we compare it to eternity, because eternity is a long, long time. Your affliction, friends, finally is last in comparison to the glory to be revealed. Paul refers to a more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. Sister White in the Review and Herald of January 11, 1898 states this: we are to be doers of the word. We are daily determining our destiny in the future life by the character we develop in this. And I just want to pause for a second and think about that, because she's not saying we are determining where we're going, whether we go high or whether we go low. But she's talking about what our life is going to be like. And what it tells me is this, very simply, friends. The quality, a quality of life that I can have throughout eternity is going to be affected by the quality of my life on this earth and how I relate to Jesus Christ.
That's right.
Now, I believe that everybody who by the grace of God makes heaven will be satisfied, but you know what? Some of us can be more satisfied. We can have a deeper, richer experience. But what we do now is going to affect the way that we can grow for eternity. And you know, those of us who are older, that ought to speak to our senses, because we don't have much time left to get things together. You folks who are a little younger, you know, don't wait time. Don't waste time. Use this now to your great advantage, to gain every possible advantage, so that throughout eternity you can enjoy the greatness of salvation, the greatness of God's creation in the universe, and understand it in a deeper, better, more joyous way than you'll ever understand it otherwise. Your affliction is light in comparison to the glory to be revealed. Handling the affliction right can increase the weight of glory. It can make us more like what God wants us to be. It can increase the weight of the reward awaiting us. The trials develop character, but the great character is developed here. But greater will be our potential and opportunity, friends, throughout all eternity. So our afflictions, friends, they're actually, the way we relate to them is a matter of focus. Do we focus on the afflictions, and then they become weary, and they become heavy, and the time becomes long? Or do we focus on what God is doing through them, and then they lose weight, and they become shorter and quicker? Whatever you're focusing on, that's what's going to determine. Whatever it is that you are going through, you will see it through God's eyes, or you're going to see it through your eyes. Will you see it as heavy and long, or will you see it as light and but for a moment? Paul says, for our light affliction, which is but for a moment. And you know what? I think we can believe it. I believe that we can believe it, and I agree with Paul. Now I want to show you one more text, one more statement. In Revelation chapter 7. Revelation chapter 7 and verse 14. Who is this group? John says, sir, thou knowest, and he said to me, these are they which came out of, the Greek says, the great tribulation, and have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. But this word for tribulation, you know what it is? It's also affliction. Same word for affliction. This group, the 144,000, affliction and tribulation will be a part of the 144,000's training. And we are told in the Spirit of Prophecy in the Review and Herald of March 9, 1905. Let us strive with all the power that God has given us to be among the 144,000. Friends, do you realize that that also means that we are to strive to welcome affliction? That we realize, friends, that's part of the program. You know, the Navy SEALs are part of what are called the United States military's special forces. The Army has its Rangers, but the Navy has the SEALs. And the SEALs are considered to be the elite of all of the elite. But they get that way through affliction. They get that way through hardship. They get that way through swimming out, back and forth in 50 degree weather. They get it by having their hands and ankles tied and have to somehow bob up and down in water for hours at a time. They get it by running mile after mile at a time. They get it by enduring pain without whimpering. The 144,000, friends, if I can say respectfully, they are God's seals. And they will be sealed by God. And we can be a part of it, but not without affliction, friends. But the good news is that God understands all this in the big picture, and He has provided for us. And He says that our affliction, though, no matter how it seems to us, when we focus on it, if we will focus on it through the eyes of God, what God is doing with it and using for, and blessing others with as well as ourselves, then it will become light, and it's but for a moment. And we can strive, friends, with all of our power to be a part of the 144,000. May God bless each one of you, lots and lots, to be a part of that group.